There are burdens that can bring us to our knees, but it's in those moments when our faith feels weakest that we simply stand our ground and just believe. Listening. And the darkness doesn't mean that he is gone, 'cause he promised he would never ever leave us, and you've never spent one moment on your own. So pray now, pray now. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
To see Jesus. Jesus, to reach out and touch Him and say that we love Him. Open our ears, Lord, and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord, we want to see Jesus.
Gracious Father, we thank you again today for the wondrous mercy that sent Jesus from heaven to this earth and had him die upon a cross so that our sins could be paid for. We rejoice in his name today. We pray that you would bless as we gather here in your name to your glory and honor. We ask that your Holy Spirit would move through our hearts and minds in this congregation of people. Open up that we might receive you and all that you are. Help us to live for you each day, that our lives might honor you wherever we go. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen. The 77s. Let's look at the first couple of verses, beginning in verse 20. They should be up on the screen. Daniel said, "While I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and making my request to the Lord, my God, for his holy hill, while I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision, came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice." That is, Gabriel, an angel, appeared in the form of a man. We know that angels are spirits. They're spiritual beings. But they can also be manifested in appearance and a form as whatever God wants them to appear like. And Gabriel came quickly. I read where someone who reads Hebrew, does anybody in here read Hebrew? I didn't think so. Neither do I. But somebody who reads Hebrew rather fluently said that he read the prayer that we shared last week from Daniel chapter 9. That is those 19 verses. And it took about a little, right at 3 minutes. But notice what Daniel says. He says, "While I was still speaking and praying." And Gabriel said that he came swiftly. So it didn't take Gabriel very long to respond to Daniel's prayer, did it? If this prayer could be read in about 3 minutes, I would just assume that it didn't take Gabriel long to get from heaven to Daniel. And you know, the prophet Isaiah promised through the Lord that when they call on him, it's before they call, God already knows the answer. And we see that Daniel, in fact, verse 1 of this chapter tells us that when this prayer and this event actually transpired, it was actually during the first year of Darius, after they had conquered Babylon and the Medo-Persians had taken over. And that's when Daniel was praying about this. And that was about 538 BC. But we remind you that his prayer was inspired to a great extent by his Bible study from the prophet Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah was older than Daniel, but he was still a contemporary. He was an older contemporary, kind of like some of us are older than some of you, but we're still living in the same, at the same time, okay? Jeremiah had prophesied a great deal about the Babylonian captivity. And yet, in chapter 29, Jeremiah said this, "When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my gracious promise to bring you back to this place." Now that was at least, I'm sure, one of the verses that Daniel was thinking about, and perhaps others, because there's other things that Jeremiah talked about that seem to sort of intermingle this 70 years with something even beyond that in the future for God's people. And yet Daniel knew that this 70-year period was certainly about to come to a close, that the time was right, had to be somewhere. And so Daniel's praying about this, but he also knew, you see, back in Deuteronomy, Moses prophesied that the people of Israel would turn away from God, and as a result, they would be carried off into captivity. And so God has fulfilled his promises. One of the things that we need to understand is, you see, God had warned Israel for a long time about the way they were living. And you know, many of us have had many warnings, cautions about our own lives. And we say, well, we really, God hasn't done anything so far, so I must have a little more time. You know, a lot of times what we do, and I think you'll agree with this, what we do is we sort of see God's line in the sand of what's right and what's wrong, and we try to move over and get as close to the line as we can and say, Lord, is this okay with you? That's the wrong attitude. When we see the line, what we need to do is say, Lord, keep me as far away from those things that you would be displeased with as I can get by getting close to you. One of the reasons that sometimes we don't know how to pray, and of course there are times when we just don't know how to pray, but God has given us his Holy Spirit to help convey what we need. He knows what we need, and he knows what God wants, because he is God. And he will convey to the Father what we need. But one of the ways in which we can understand more of what we need is to do what Daniel was doing, and let our prayers be inspired by God's word to us. You see, a relationship involves communication, not just one way, but two ways. And so it's not only important that you and I pray, but also that we let God speak to us. And the main way that God speaks to us the most clearly is through the scriptures. And Daniel was using those scriptures, and he says, but he also knew that repentance had to happen before restoration could occur. You know what? Repentance is more than merely saying, I'm sorry. Repentance is allowing God to dig down deep into our hearts and show us who we really are. And then to say, God, I don't want to be like that anymore. I want to be what you want me to be. Help me. And listen, if you will do that honestly and in the confidence that whatever God desires, God can cause to happen. You see, I couldn't keep... how many of us have made resolutions, you know, and we couldn't keep them? Well, it isn't that we couldn't keep most of them, but we don't often keep them. But let me tell you, when you make a commitment to the Lord, God is able to help you keep that commitment. He's able to do that. Now, whatever temptation, whatever struggle you're facing, God says there's no temptation but such as is common to man. And with every temptation, he writes through the Apostle Paul, he will make a means of escape. That is, we don't have to succumb to those temptations. God will enable us if we want him to. But that's the key. Do we want him to? Now, the Lord's quick response to Daniel's prayer. He, that is Gabriel, instructed Daniel and said to me, "Daniel, I have come to give you insight and understanding. As soon as you begin to pray, an answer was given which I have come to tell you. For you are highly esteemed. Therefore, consider the message and understand the vision." Now, Daniel, again, was undoubtedly aware of those 70 years that Jeremiah had mentioned. But notice he went on further and told him this in verse 24. 77s are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. And by the way, I want to tell you, verses 24 through 27 are probably, there's probably nowhere else in the Old Testament that there is a variety of opinions on than you will discover in these four verses. And I'm going to try to sort them out as best I can and as humbly as I know how, realizing that I am not God, but we will do our best to help you grasp this passage of Scripture as we understand it. Now, the 77s refers to 70 periods of seven. That would mean about 490 years. 70 periods of seven, or about 490 years. And the message, notice, Gabriel said, the message is for your, who's your? Daniel. For your, Daniel's people. Who are were Daniel's people? Israel, the Jews, and your or his holy city. What was that city? Jerusalem. Okay. Now keep that in mind. I think that's important to understand this. Six objectives are to be accomplished in this time frame. Let's look at those objectives. The first three involve bringing rebellion, sin, and iniquity to an end. Remember? 77s are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, and to atone for wickedness. Then the last three relate to the fulfillment of all prophetic events, ushering in everlasting righteousness, and the anointing of the Most Holy. I believe most likely that refers to the Lord Jesus. Some believe it refers to a temple that will be erected in the future. But at any place, the Lord Jesus will be its glory and its anointing. Now, these six objectives, let's look at them quickly, one by one. to finish transgression. That word transgression is rebellion. In the Hebrew, it really means rebellion. And so, part of this 77s, during that time, there's going to be a time when there's going to be an end to Israel's rebellion against God. Secondly, to put an end to sin, that is, to finish off Israel's wrongs. And then to atone for wickedness. In some versions, it talks about to make reconciliation. Well, that's what atoning is. As atonement means reconciling. And we need to be reconciled to God because sin separates us from God. Sin has separated us from the holy God. And we don't have fellowship with Him as a lost sinner. And so we need the atonement. Do you remember? See, a lot of people, they think that if I just live a good life, I try to be a good moral person. And a lot of people are on our standards, by our standards, they seem to be good moral people. In fact, you would like to have them as a good neighbor. They would be friendly. If you needed something, they'd volunteer to help. There's a lot of moral people. But my standard and your standard does not reach God's standard. God's standard is absolute sinlessness. And we don't reach that. And so, even in the Old Testament, you remember in the Old Testament, we kept reading time and time again, they had priests that would offer sacrifices that were sacrifices offered every day, sacrifices in especially on one specific day of the week, the year, that was offered for all the nation. Why did they need a sacrifice? If just by being a good man, a good woman, a good boy, or a good girl, that was good enough. If God was just going to balance, I'm this much good and I'm only this much bad. If that was good enough, then why did God require in the Old Testament that an animal had to be sacrificed as a substitute or in place of what the sinner deserved? Why would that happen if just our being good was enough? Well, all of those Old Testament sacrifices actually was just a picture of the sacrifice that God was going to give us through His Lamb, Jesus Christ. And if it were not for Jesus Christ, no matter how good a lives we seemed or appear to be living, all of us would come short of God's glory and we would fail Him and we would stand in judgment. You know, even here in our world, we have an illustration of that in our judicial system. You know, everyone who is brought before a judge and found guilty is not always found guilty for the exact same things or to the exact degree of ugliness. Right? But there's still a penalty that is exacted. Then he says also to bring in everlasting righteousness. This is, I believe, the predicted righteous government of the Messiah. In Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 7, we read that when Jesus comes at the end of the age, that He is going to govern in righteousness. And then to seal up vision and prophecy. In that day, the Old Testament prophecies promised to Israel will be fulfilled. And to anoint the Most Holy again. I think in particular it's referring to the Lord Jesus. Now let's talk about, as Gabriel did, the division of those 77s. Look at verse 25. Know and understand this. From the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the anointed one, the ruler, comes, there will be 7 sevens and 62 sevens. It will be rebuilt with streets and a trench, but in times of trouble. After the 62 sevens, the anointed one will be cut off and will have nothing. Some translations from the Hebrew says that, but not for himself. He will be cut off, but not for himself. The people of the ruler who will come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue until the end, and desolations have been decreed. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 seven in the middle of the seven. He will put an end to sacrifice and offering. And on a wing of the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him. Sounds confusing, doesn't it? The 77s, Gabriel told Daniel, will commence from the issuing of the decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Now, there's two or three times dates that some have in mind. I believe that it's talking about the decree that went during the time of Nehemiah, which was about 445 BC. You remember Nehemiah was a cupbearer of Artaxerxes. And he got really disturbed because the Jews had already returned, but they had not really been successful in rebuilding the city and the temple. And so Artaxerxes gave a decree or permission, a sign, written letters to the authorities, the various governmental authorities of all the little individual nations around Jerusalem, to let them know that Nehemiah was coming and that they were going to begin to rebuild Jerusalem. During the first, and you can read about that, by the way, in Nehemiah chapter 2. During the first 7 sevens, 7 times 7 is 49. Okay, 49 years, Jerusalem would be rebuilt, but Gabriel says in times of trouble. Well, there was time of trouble. If you read Nehemiah, you see that they actually, while they were building the wall, they had to stand guard. They had to have their weapons on hand because it was a time of trouble. Then after 69 sevens, that is 483 years, this is 7 sevens, the 49, plus the 434, 62 sevens, the anointed one, the ruler, comes. Amazing. This happened when Jesus began his ministry in 29 or 30 AD. Isn't that amazing? Now, I want to point this out to you because of this. Some of this prophecy has not been fulfilled yet. But I want to tell you something. The fact that God has already historically for us fulfilled this prophecy ought to give us a measure of thought to know that what he said yet to come is going to come. Amen. Just like he said it. The ancients used a solar year. In other words, every month was basically 30 days. They didn't have the 365 and a quarter days calendar like we do. And by the way, just to illustrate this, how many of you notice that last year, Easter came in April, right? This year, you know when it comes? In March. Now, why would that be? Because it was on the Jewish calendar, a 360-day period. Ah, yeah, somebody said, oh. So it's going to vary from year to year. Well, that's why if you start using our system to try to compute these dates up, you'll come up with a little different figure than what we've given you here, because you're using the wrong dates unless you use the 360 days. Now, 483 of these solar years from the issue of the decree mentioned earlier brings us again to 29 or 30 AD. And after the 62 sevens. So in other words, now we're talking, that's after not only the 62 sevens, but we've already had seven sevens before that. So now we're talking 69 weeks out of 70, right? Everybody with me? Say amen if you're still here. Okay. Say, oh man, if you're not. Okay. All right, so we had 49 years, and then we had 434 years, adding up to 483 years. Okay. It says that after the 62 sevens, the anointed one will be cut off and will have nothing. Verse 26. Of course, this is a reference to the rejection of Christ Jesus by the Jews and his crucifixion. You remember the Jews cried out. This is a quote from Luke 19. We will not have this man to reign over us. They also said, John recorded, basically, Caesar is our king. We have no king but Caesar, they said. And Luke says, we will not have this man to reign over us. And in this verse, it talks about the people of the ruler who will come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. This predicted the destruction of the temple by the Roman armies in 70 AD. You remember Jesus in Matthew chapter 24, Jesus was conversing with his disciples and he had said, he had made a comment that this, temple would be destroyed. And his disciples asked, well, when's this going to happen? Tell us, when will this be? And they ask another question, and when, what will be, the end time? They thought probably all of this would be happen at the same time. That was kind of their thinking. I want you to notice that this was done by the people of the ruler who will come. Not by the ruler himself, for this ruler is yet to come on the scene in the future. I understand this to simply mean is, in other words, this ruler was not Titus. This ruler will come, will have, basically, he will come from the background of the people who destroyed the temple in 70 AD. Who was that? The Romans. And remember, the Romans had a widespread. They owned pretty much, they governed pretty much all of Europe. And the last verse indicates that when that ruler comes and makes a covenant or a treaty with Israel, remember who was this about? Daniel's people and Daniel's holy city. When that ruler comes and makes a covenant or treaty with Israel, the final 7-year period will begin. It'll be the last 7 years of earth before Jesus comes again. In the middle of that last 7 years, the ruler to come, the Antichrist, as we're called in the New Testament, will break the covenant that he made with Israel and force the world to worship him. Jesus said of this time in Matthew 24 and verse 21, "For then there will be great distress unequaled from the beginning of the world until now and never to be equaled again." The Apostle Paul wrote about this man. He called the man of lawlessness in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. He says, "Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshiped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God." That occurs. Isn't going to be long till the second coming. Now, before that, I believe there's going to be a rapture of God's people before that 7-year period. That last seven years, that is the church. We might ask ourselves, well, since that had so much to do with Daniel's people, and maybe none of us here, I don't know, some of us may be of Jewish background. I don't know. But most of us aren't. We're called Gentiles. So you say, well, Pastor, what does that have to do with me? Well, do you know that the same guidelines and the same Savior was sent for both Jew and Gentile. There's one Lord and one faith and one Spirit, that is one Holy Spirit. There's one way to heaven, and that's by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the only way. There's one hope for the world, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ and God's forgiveness. And so we need to ask ourselves, are we this very day anything like Israel was, rebelling against the Lord? Have we repented of our sins, and are we, by the grace and mercy and power of the Lord Jesus, walking, following in the footsteps of Jesus? Do we, like the Apostle John wrote at the end of the revelation given him by the Lord Jesus, after he said and even gave an even bigger descriptive of these end time events, he said this: "Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus." Is that something you can honestly invite without fear or reservation, but with a heart of joy Let's pray. Heavenly Father, O God, help us. Help us to look and see ourselves as you see us. Help us to pray as Daniel prayed, repenting of our sins. And on the foundation of your mercy and not our own righteousness. Dear Lord, if there's anyone here this very morning who has never made a personal and public commitment to follow Jesus, inviting you to direct their lives, seeking to love you because you first loved them. Dear Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit would challenge them, invite them, draw them to you. And I ask it in the precious name of the Lord. Amen.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see.